Why even angels worship should set his love upon the sons of men. Oh, why have shepherds he should seek the wanderers to bring them back, they know not how or when. But this I know, that he was born of Mary, when Bethlehem's manger was his only home, and that he lived at Nazareth and labored, and so the Savior of the world is come. I cannot tell how silently he suffered, as with his peace he graced this place of tears. For how his heart upon the cross was broken, the crown of pain to 33 years. But this I know, he heals the broken hearted, and saves our sin, and calms our lurking fears, and lifts a burden from the heavy laden. For yet a Saviour, Saviour of the world is here. I cannot tell how he will win the nations, how he will claim his earthly heritage, how satisfy the needs and aspirations of East and West, of sinner and of sage. But this I know, all flesh shall see his glory, and he shall reap the harvest he has sown. And some glad day his sun shall shine in splendor, when he the Saviour, Saviour of the world is known. I cannot tell how all the land shall worship, when at his bidding every storm is still. For who can say how great the jubilation, when all the hearts of men with love are filled? But this I know, the skies will thrill with rapture, and myriad, myriad voices and voices sing. And earth to heaven, and heaven to earth will answer, at last the Saviour, Saviour of the world is
king. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Cafe Church with a little bit of a difference. I don't know if you've noticed, but there's one or two little things different in the church because we've set up the Easter experience, and we're going to be saying a lot more about that later on in the service. But on your table, I'm sorry, it's a bit of a squeeze, obviously, because of that. We can't really use the side aisles this morning. So sorry, there's a bit sort of cramped this morning. But on your tables, if you are around a table, you will find lots of goodies. Please do tuck into them during the service. We don't want to see any food left at the end of the service, so do tuck into that. And of course, also on your tables, you've got the Cafe Church colouring sheets. So we want to see your Monets, your Manets, your Minis, your Monets. No, I think a couple of those exist and a couple of them don't. But anyway, so do some colouring, and we'll have a look at your works of art later on in the service. So we're going to start off with a song. This is It's Not Following Jesus, I think. Thank you. Right, come and grab an instrument. Come on, Millie. The others as well.
Don't be shy.
Hey. Oh, here we go. Grab an instrument. Okay, we're going to be on the screen. We'll remain seated to sing our songs this morning. Please do join in. Let's sing It's an Adventure Following Jesus.
It's an adventure following Jesus. It's an adventure learning of Him. It's an adventure knowing for Jesus. It's an adventure following Him. Let's go where He leads us. Turn away from hell. For we know we can trust Him to help us as we follow along. It's an adventure following Jesus. It's an adventure learning of Him. It's an adventure living for Jesus. It's an adventure following Him. It's an adventure following Jesus. It's an adventure learning of Him. It's an adventure living on Jesus. It's an adventure following Him. Let's go where He leads us. Turn away from wrong. For we know we can trust Him to help us as we go along. It's an adventure following Jesus. It's an adventure learning of Him. It's an adventure learning from Jesus. It's an adventure following Him. It's an adventure following Jesus. It's an adventure learning of Him. It's an adventure living from Jesus. It's an adventure following Him.
Let's hear it for the band! Okay. Now, one of the things we want to do this morning is we want to give you a little bit of a flavour of the Easter experience. Please do take the opportunity after the end of the service to go and have a proper look at everything you can see behind me as well, because there's a lot to see one way and another. So, of course, obviously, the Easter experience shows us a little bit like, shows us a little bit what it might have looked like a little bit in the last week of Jesus' life, the different scenes and stories that we read about in what we call Holy Week, which is going to be coming up in a couple of weeks' time. And in the coming week, the school, the whole of St. Peter's School, is going to come over class by class, and we're going to take them on a walkthrough of the Easter experience. And the story is told through the eyes of Peter, because obviously Peter was a witness to all of the events that happened. Peter saw them all happen, and we're going to tell the story through the eyes of Peter. So just to show you a little bit about what it's going to be like, the story actually starts at the very beginning when Jesus calls Peter. So we've got a Sea of Galilee at the back there. And I'm afraid, Friday, folks, if you weren't here Friday evening, you were missing a treat as we got the boat into the church. That was a fun experience. So we have the boat for the Sea of Galilee. Jesus calls Peter to follow him. Then we fast forward 3 years to Jesus' triumphal entry through the city gate, the city gate of Jerusalem. And we come here to the Last Supper. We set a marquee up here, and inside that is a table set up for the Last Supper. And of course, one of the things that happened at the Last Supper was that Jesus said to Peter, "This very evening, Peter, you're going to say that you don't even know me." And you're not going to say that once, you're going to say it three times. Peter couldn't believe it. And as we show the kids around, we're going to be playing some audio bits of an imaginary diary that Peter might have written, reflecting on events of Holy Week. So let's listen to Peter's account of what happened at that point.
"Over the last 3 years, I'd got really close to Jesus. I saw him do incredible things. I thought he was amazing, and I would have done anything for him. That's why I was so shocked by what happened next. After the Passover dinner was finished, we wandered over to the Mount of Olives. Jesus took me to one side and said, well, I can hardly bear to write it. He said that on that very night, I would pretend I didn't know him. Not once, not twice, but three times. I would hear a cockerel crow and I would remember what he was telling me. I couldn't believe it. Not me. I'd never do that to Jesus."
So as Peter said, when they finished the Last Supper, they went across to the Garden of Gethsemane that we've got over there. And of course, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus took Peter, James and John with him, and he went off. And Jesus knew what was going to happen to him. And he prayed to God and he said, "If there's any way to get me out of this, please, you know, please get me out of this. But I know it's your will. I trust you and I'm prepared to go through it." And then, as, of course, as we know, the soldiers came and arrested Jesus. They took Jesus off to the high priest's house, the courtyard, which we're going to set up over there. We've got a little fire pit and a cockroach. We used it with... when we did this 10 years ago, we had live chickens or what have you. We got a pretend cockerel over there. And of course, Peter followed at a distance. Peter wanted to know what was going on, but he didn't want to be recognized. So he went to the courtyard outside the high priest's house as the trial was going on. And of course, as we know, he was then challenged as to whether he knew Jesus or not. Let's hear another bit of his diary.
"This girl came up to me and she said she had seen me with Jesus. Oh, I panicked and said, I don't know what she was talking about, but she just kept on and on. This man is one of those followers of Jesus, she said. Again, I pretended I didn't know him. And a bit later, some other guys said they thought I was a friend of Jesus because they recognized my accent. Then I lost it. I shouted, I swear to you that I don't know this man you're talking about. And then I heard the cockerel crow. And I remembered what Jesus had said. He'd said that I would pretend I didn't know him three times. I had told him I would never do that. But I just had. I just fell to the floor and cried and cried.
So, Peter has denied knowing Jesus three times, and that's a sort of a little bit of a flavor of perhaps what Peter's diary, imaginary diary, that the children are going to be looking at during this coming week. Well, we've heard a little bit about how Peter might have felt. Let's watch a video which sort of reminds us again of that story.
The Miracle of Mercy, Peter. This is Peter.
Heyo! Whoop!
Peter was a fisherman who was called by Jesus.
Hey!
Peter saw the many miracles of Jesus and he heard all of his teachings. When the time came for Jesus to die and take away the sins of all the world, Jesus had one final meal with his friends. During this meal, Jesus told his followers that the time had come for him to leave them.
Huh?
Peter asked, "Where are you going?" Jesus told him Peter couldn't follow him now.
What?
But that he would follow him later.
What are you talking?
But Peter said, "Why can't I come now? I'm ready to die for you." Jesus said, "Die for me, Peter. Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny three times that you even knew me." Then Jesus and his disciples went to the Mount of Olives so Jesus could pray. Along the way, Jesus told his followers that they would all abandon him.
Uh-oh!
But Peter said, "Even if everyone else leaves you, I never will." Jesus said, "Peter, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny three times that you even know me." But Peter wouldn't believe it and vowed that he would stay with Jesus until the very end. The other disciples vowed the same.
Yeah, I do.
Later on that night, Jesus was arrested by men sent by the religious teachers and priests. Peter tried to fight for Jesus. And he cut off the ear of one of the guards. But Jesus healed the guard and went quietly with the captors. All the disciples scattered just as Jesus told them they would. The men led Jesus away to the house of the high priest. Peter and another disciple followed them. Peter came to warm himself by their fire.
Hello.
A servant girl noticed him in the firelight.
Uh-huh.
Finally, she said, "This man was one of Jesus' followers."
Oh, ma.
But Peter denied it for the first time. He said, "I don't even know him." After a while, someone else looked at him and said, "You must be one of them."
Oh.
Peter, for a second time, said, "No, I'm not."
Okay.
About an hour later, a man who knew the man whose ear Peter cut off said, "Didn't I see you in the olive grove with Jesus? This must be one of them. He comes from the same place as all of them."
Yeah, you're right.
But Peter said,
"No, no, no.
I don't know what you're talking about." And then Peter heard the crow of the rooster. Jesus turned and looked at Peter. Jesus' words flashed through his mind, and Peter left the courtyard weeping. Then Jesus died and was placed in a tomb. The disciples heard that he had come back from the dead. Peter even saw the empty tomb and believed that Jesus was alive again.
Woo-hoo!
And Jesus appeared to the disciples to show him that he was alive.
Now, on Tuesday morning, we had year four from the school come over, and Katie's going to come and tell us what we did. We had a lot of fun, didn't we, Katie? Looks like you're having a lot of fun.
Sorry, tissue emergency. We've had a really busy week, as Tim's already alluded to. So on Tuesday, we had not quite all of year four, because unfortunately quite a lot were off poorly, but we had lots of year four, who are the penguins and puffins? Fours? Yep, okay, I'm getting nods from year fours, so I've got that right. Came over to church, and we did our sort of normal year group visit structure, which we do now, which is half of the morning was spent doing some prayer stations. So we set up five prayer stations around the church, which are centered on the school value of the term. Should I put a year four on the spot? Can we remember? Yes, it's Tilly, isn't it? Yeah. The value of the term is?
Service.
Perfect. Okay, excellently remembered. So we were doing various activities. We'll quickly show you a little example. Okay, here we go. So we've got, we thought about serving others. So we did some thankful, some giving hands, some service hands of things we might do, particularly during Lent, to serve others. And for example, I got children to think about, you know, different symbols and synonyms of service, and they've covered this lovely big poster here in those. We had, I think I mentioned last month, we had the order of the most excellent office of St. Peter's School awards. So that was lovely to take in the following day. They'd all appointed different people who deserved this award for serving their school community. We were able to give about 30 medals to be presented in school, and the children picked excellent examples from dinner ladies to their class teacher to occasionally, I think, like a football coach, and even the safeguarding lead, to thankful for keeping the school safe at all times. So that was lovely. And then the other half of the morning was spent exploring. This year we're really focusing on helping the children explore who St. Peter is, because obviously it's so important as the name of their school. And we looked at these passages. We looked at Peter's denial and then Peter being reinstated by Jesus. And we did some more artwork, as always. So we've got a sort of double, they had to do two colouring scenes, one of Peter denying Jesus and one of Jesus reinstating Peter. I think it's slightly double-sided, isn't it, Tim?
Yeah.
Okay, so they did an excellent job. I think they deserve a round of applause, particularly those who are here this morning. And the other thing that we have the pleasure of viewing today, there is actually going to be two videos. We're just going to watch the first video now. But we asked the children to reflect on, how do you feel if either you're let down by somebody or you yourself let somebody down? So we've got some of their responses now on a video.
Upset and lonely. I feel annoyed because whenever someone lets you down, they kind of like make you feel sad and upset because they did something you don't want them to do.
I feel very guilty.
Very upset. I feel annoyed because my brother, he's annoying when he lets me down.
Upset.
If someone lets you down, you could feel like very sad and like lonely and like, maybe like emotional.
Makes you feel sad and maybe a bit like left out because you've been let down by someone and they could be your friend.
If it's my friends, then I would feel like pretty betrayed and heartbroken.
When someone lets you down, it feels like they're there for you.
Right.
But if you feel upset or let down, then you'll probably be let down by someone you really care about, because normally you wouldn't feel let down if someone you don't really know upsets you. But if it's someone you know, you'll feel really upset because you really love them and want to be like them, but they let you down.
But if I let someone down, or if someone let me down, then I think I'll be upset and wouldn't be very happy.
When you let somebody down, you feel bad for them and you just feel like you've let them down even more.
I would betray someone. They would probably feel upset because we would probably be friends.
Like, you just don't want to be with them for a couple of days just to calm down and what's happened.
Give a big round of applause. Okay, so we've seen how Peter let down Jesus big time, really, when he said that he didn't know him three times. Just when Jesus needed Peter, he let him down. And of course, we know that Jesus was put on trial. He was sentenced to death. And then the following day, he was obviously taken off and crucified. And Peter just couldn't hack it. He knew that he'd messed up. Let's listen to what he might have in his diary.
I'm not sure if it was guilt, shame, or fear, but I couldn't be there. I just couldn't watch Jesus die. A few people did go along and see it happen. His mum, Mary, while she was there, she wouldn't leave her son. She would stay with him until the end. But I thought he was the Messiah, the one sent to rescue us. Why was he dying? How could this be God's plan?
So not only was Peter feeling really bad about what he'd done, but he got lots of questions. He just couldn't understand why this had happened. And not only why did it happen, but as he thought about it, he sort of thought it almost seemed as if Jesus did know what was going to happen to him. And he'd actually, in a sense, gone through with it when he could have, Jesus perhaps earlier could have run away himself, but he didn't. So Peter really didn't understand what was going on. And we know, of course, that after Jesus died, his body was taken down from the cross and it was put in the tomb. Please do go and have a look at the tomb later on. Fantastic construction by Darren. And then the big stone was rolled across the tomb. And then, of course, 2 days later on the Sunday morning, some of the women who had followed Jesus went to the tomb. And, well, they found it a little bit like we see it now. The stone was no longer in front of the tomb. And the body that had been in the tomb wasn't in the tomb anymore. And the women went, they ran to Peter and John to tell them what had happened. And this just seemed to raise more and more questions for Peter. Let's hear what he might have written in his diary on that first Easter Sunday morning.
I just don't know what to think. I've come to the tomb. I ran here because the women told us that the stone at the entrance to the tomb had been rolled to one side and the tomb was empty. They said they'd seen Jesus alive. Apparently, two men appeared out of nowhere wearing clothes as bright as lightning and said to the women, "Why are you looking for a living person in a place for the dead? Jesus isn't here. He's alive." But then the women said they went outside and actually met Jesus. He actually spoke to them. He was alive. Meanwhile, we were all hiding in town. And the women, they ran back to tell us about it. And me and John, we raced to the tomb to check for ourselves. They were right. The tomb was completely empty. As for the rest of it, well, I'm not sure what to believe.
And I guess Peter, on that first Easter Sunday morning, before he'd seen Jesus himself, of course, he was to go on to see him later, but he didn't see him actually on that first morning. And I guess he feels a little bit like we often feel like as well, because we can hear these stories like we're hearing this morning about the fact that this event that happened 2,000 years ago, that a person who was dead is alive again. It is quite literally the most extraordinary story that there's ever been in human history. And of course, the big question is it really true? And that, of course, was the question that Peter was wrestling with himself. Can it really be true? Well, we're going to have a bit more to think about that in a moment. We're going to sing a song now. This is the song called Servant King.
not to be served, but to serve. And give your life that we might give. This is our God, the servant King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily worship to the servant King. There in the garden of tears, my heavy load He chose to bear. His heart with sorrow was torn. Yet not my will, but yours He said. This is our God, the servant King. He calls us now follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant King. Come see His hands and His feet, the scars that speak of sacrifice, hands that flung stars into space, to cruelness surrender. This is our God,
this is our God,
the servant King,
the servant King.
He calls us now,
He calls us
to follow Him, to bring our lives,
to bring our lives,
offering,
an offering,
a worship to.
Worship to the servant King.
So let us learn how to serve, and in our lives enthrone Him. Each of us needs to prefer, for it is Christ in serving. This is our God,
this is our God,
the servant King,
the servant King.
He calls us now,
He calls us
now.
Worship to the servant King.
Okay, we're just going to have a break just for a couple of minutes and just an opportunity to finish off your colouring sheets and grab something on the table to eat, and I'll call us back in a couple of minutes. Just an opportunity just to stretch your legs. We won't be serving drinks at the back at this point. There'll be drinks available at the end, but just an opportunity just to stand up and stretch your legs just for a moment, and then I'll call us back together. Can already see some amazing works of art. Bring them up on the stage, hold them up high. Look at these, ladies and gentlemen. Wow. We've got some nice gentle pastel shades, and we've got some full-on Technicolor ones going on here. Are there any more? Where are the adults? Come on, yes, quite right. Come on, adults. Is it too good? Come on. Is that yours, Michael? Very good. Hold it up high. Stand up where you are and hold it up. You can't stand up. Oh, don't. There we go. Look at that, ladies and gentlemen. Whoa. There, look at that. Brilliant. Let's give them all a big round of applause. Well done. So, we've sort of left our story this morning at the point at Easter Sunday morning when, well, there are rumours flying around that something quite extraordinary has happened, because the women have gone to the tomb, they found the tomb empty, and they claim to have seen Jesus. And Peter is sort of thinking, what on earth is going on here? Well, of course, when we read further on in the story in the Bible, we see that, of course, Jesus appeared to Peter that same evening. In fact, he appeared to many people over several weeks. And there was one occasion when Jesus appeared to several of his disciples when they were by the lakeside. In fact, Jesus cooked them a breakfast, and we're going to watch a video now. This is really the second part of the video we saw earlier on. This is what happens next.
Some of Jesus's followers were together when Peter said, "I am going fishing."
Uh-huh.
So they all went out to the sea, but caught nothing all night. At dawn, they saw a man standing on the beach.
Oh, hey, over here.
The man called out to them and said, "Have you caught any fish?"
"Nope,"
The man said, "Throw out your net on the right side and you'll get some."
Okay.
So they did, and they couldn't bring in the net because there were so many fish in it. Then one of the men on the boat said to Peter, "It's Jesus." When Peter heard that it was Jesus, he swam to the shore while the others pulled in the load to the boat. When they got there, they found breakfast waiting for them.
Remission fish. Got it.
Jesus said, "Come have some breakfast." While they were eating, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter said, "Yes, you know I love you." So Jesus said, "Then feed my lambs." Then Jesus asked again, "Do you love me?" Peter said again, "Yes, you know I love you." And Jesus said, "Then take care of my sheep." And then a third time, Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. So he said, "You know everything. You know that I love you." So Jesus said one last time, "Then feed my sheep." And so Peter went on to feed Jesus' sheep by helping establish the church and by writing books that we can now read in the Bible. And though he denied Jesus, he was forgiven. And many came to know the love and forgiveness of Jesus through Peter.
So Jesus asked Peter a question. He said, "Peter, do you love me?" Now, normally, when you ask someone a question and you get an answer, you sort of move on, don't you? You maybe ask something else differently, but you sort of move on. But the interesting thing, as we saw in that video, was that Jesus asks Peter exactly the same question three times. And it's almost as if Jesus is just checking Peter out, as if, you know, just to make sure that the answer that Peter's giving, he's sure that he's giving him the right answer. "Peter, do you really love me?" "Yes," Peter says. "You know I love you." And then a third time, "Peter, do you really love me?" "Yes." And most people, I don't know what Peter necessarily thought at the time, I suspect maybe he did think this, and I'm sure he probably thought about it later on, when he sort of thought about, why did Jesus ask me that question three times? And a lot of people think, and I think they're probably right, that one of the main reasons that Jesus asked Peter that same question three times is that he was triggering a thought in Peter's mind of what had happened just a few weeks earlier. Because, of course, as we'd heard earlier on, a few weeks earlier, Peter had denied knowing Jesus three times. He'd been asked three times whether he knew him, and three times he'd said he didn't. And I think that was probably one of the worst moments in Peter's life. Jesus was his best friend. He'd spent 3 years with him. And yet when it came to the crunch at that crucial moment, three times Peter said he didn't know Jesus. It was the worst moment of his life. But what Jesus, I think, is doing here in this story is that he's giving Peter an opportunity to put it right. Peter had let Jesus down, but now Jesus, even though he was let down by Peter, he's giving Peter a chance to put those three times right by saying three times that he loves him. And that's what Jesus does. Jesus is a second chance sort of person. He's a second chance God. What I mean by that is that when we let him down, he always gives us an opportunity to put it right. And so if we think for a moment about maybe the worst times in our lives, like that worst time that Peter had when he let Jesus down, maybe that time in our life that we regret doing something or saying something, and we sort of think there's no way back from that. And maybe that has haunted us, maybe for a long time since whatever it was happened. And we think There's no way of putting that right. But there's always a way with Jesus. Jesus can find a way in our lives to give us a second chance to put right those things that we've messed up on, just like Peter had messed up. Jesus gave Peter that chance to put it right. And Peter took that chance. And Jesus said to him, okay then. And he says, take care of my lambs, or take care of my sheep. And of course, he's using picture language there. What he's basically saying is, Peter, you share with other people the love that I have for you. You then share that with other people. And that's what we're all called to do. When Jesus gives us a second chance, we should give other people a second chance. We should take care of other people, just like Jesus told Peter to. We need to do the same as well. Now, I think Katie's going to come up briefly again. Because, as you said, got another bit of video.
We have. So this is part two of year four, answering some questions about what they'd learned about on Tuesday. So the question they were given this time was, how does it feel when we are forgiven?
It makes us feel happy. When we are forgiven, you feel happy and really relieved.
It'll be a relief for everybody.
We get so controlled. Then you won't be sad and all of your problems will just be like done. And then you'll be happy again.
Whenever someone forgives you, you might feel something.
I feel better because they've forgiven us.
Full of happiness.
But then when you're forgiven, you're happy.
I feel so joyful.
It will make you feel happy because then you can just all forget about it.
You might feel happy because you might feel really sad. No one might not be sad.
It makes me feel happy.
Happy.
Yes, let's give a big applause. Okay, yeah, and a great way. Woo, fantastic. Okay, so as they were saying, the great thing about forgiveness is, I'm going to have this background now for the next 5 minutes, aren't I? The great thing about forgiveness is that it makes you feel good, doesn't it? It makes you feel good when you're forgiven something. It's actually also feels good when you forgive someone else, actually, because it lets go of something that we're carrying within ourselves as well. And we're going to sing a song about how good that can feel. I'm going to jump up and down. I'm going to spin right around. Now, I need some people up the front here to do some actions with me. So I want to guess, let's get some people up the front here. Come on up. I want you to do some actions with me. Who's up for some actions? Come on, put your hands up. Where's Lucy? Charlie, come on up. George, Millie, everyone else. Okay, right. We're going to do some actions as we sing this song. So you've got to follow me. I don't know why I'm saying you've got to follow me, because I don't know that I've got the foggiest idea what we're going to do.
Claire
knows. Okay. But we're going to try. Okay, let's do the actions to this.
I'm gonna jump up and down, gonna sing my plan, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna
shout out loud,
gonna get in the crowd, gonna sing my praise forever. I'm gonna jump up and down, gonna sing my plan, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna
shout out loud,
gonna get in the crowd, gonna sing my praise forever. I'm the one who's grace and I won't let us stop. Follow Jesus till the day I drop. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you've got such a lot, when you've got not a lot, what? Be happy. Gonna jump up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna
shout
heaven and glad I'm gonna send my praise to heaven. I won this race and I will never stop. I follow Jesus till the day I drop. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you got such a lot, when you got not a lot, when you got such a lot, when you got not a lot, when you got such a lot, when you got not a lot, what? Be happy.
If someone could just get me a couple of my pills, I'd be really appreciative. Much. Okay, right. Stephen's going to come and lead us. Let's pray.
Yesterday, I was here with Messy Church, and a good time was had by all. Everyone had the opportunity to visit the Easter experience in all its glory. Next week, the school will come over and get an understanding of the week before and after Jesus' crucifixion. The following Monday is open to all. It is our delight to explain Jesus' death to others. And as we sit, let us pray. We pray for opportunities to present themselves, to tell how Jesus died on the cross. He rose again and helps us with our everyday lives. He wants to know our problems and he will help. I've been through various illnesses and unemployment, living on benefits. But through active prayer, the Lord has provided a way through the maze. He can turn water into wine. He can make the blind see. If he can do that, he can certainly help us with a little money problem.
We have now entered spring. We are all going forward in the warmth of the spring weather. Flowers are starting to grow and blossom appearing on trees. New birth, new foods, spring onions, Jersey potatoes, new fruit appearing, new job, new friends, family trips to the park or the seaside. We give thanks to our Lord for his provision for us, especially the fine weather and the opportunities to meet with friends outdoors.
We think of our friends abroad, including the Lupin Elderly People's Home in Romania, a long way from Ukraine. And I haven't heard yet if they're taking refugees. But it brings to mind 1989, when we were treated like secret police. Everyone there was very guarded about what they said to us, in case they would be detained. 10 years earlier, they would have been. The Soviet Union had a huge influence on the country. Similarly, I imagine, like Ukraine, before Vladimir Zelensky. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask for wisdom and reductions in weapons to the benefit of mankind. We ask for peace and unity in the world. We ask for the welfare of the people fleeing the Ukraine situation. We ask that they may receive the sanctuary they need.
As a mother shows tenderness and mercy to its young, we ask for blessings to surround newborn babies. Remembering the ones usually recently baptized, as we move forward towards Easter, we think of the egg as a symbol of new life, new beginnings, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and our guide.
We pray for our local bishops, Viv and Lee, the vicar, lay readers, our singing group, our coffee team, our house groups, our messy church, our soft play workers, our flower team, our congregation, and our youth. We pray their health. We pray for their health and that of our community. We ask God to bless them all, and we pray their time and commitment will be rewarded. We are all expecting energy prices to continue to rise, and this will cause difficulties to some in our parish, and we pray that they will get the help they require.
We ask for good health to surround the recovery of those we know who are unwell or have been given bad news or are in hospital. We know Jesus is by their side. Jesus asked men to stop fishing and follow him. He is still asking us to give time and commitment to follow him. There are many in this building today who can speak to his changing lives for good.
Last week, I prayed that President Putin will pull his troops back and realize our expectation to live in harmony with him. I feel a limited answer to prayer has happened. Jesus, we ask you, listen to our prayers throughout next week, and we are trusting in you for an answer. Amen.
Thank you, Stephen and Rachel. So this coming Tuesday, the Tuesday coffee morning has got a trip to Wells. There are some spaces available on that. So if you would like to go to Wells, then please see Martin afterwards. Next Sunday is, of course, Palm Sunday, beginning of Holy Week. By the way, the Easter experience is going to stay up until beyond Easter, until after Easter, okay? So the whole of our Easter work services are going to be in the context and setting of the Easter experience. So next Sunday is Palm Sunday. And then the following Thursday, so that's a week on Thursday, which I think is the 14th, Maundy Thursday, we're going to be having our Maundy Thursday meal at 2 here in church. So there's a sheet at the back. There's going to be a bring and share supper. So if you would like to come, please do sign up on the list at the back. There's also a sheet of various different food to bring. So please do tick an item, something to bring on that. So that's Maundy Thursday evening for our meal together, which will also include, as it normally does, communion. So that's Maundy Thursday. Then, of course, the following day is Good Friday, a week on Friday. Good Friday, we're going to have our normal 3-hour service, but it's what we call a come and go service. So you're welcome to come at any point in the service. It's not one of those you have to come necessarily at the beginning. You can just drop in and out of it, as it were. So that starts at midday and goes on till 3 o'clock. That's Good Friday. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, a fortnight today, Easter Sunday. One of the things we're going to do on Easter Sunday is there's going to be opportunity for all of us to affirm our baptismal faith. Cass has specifically asked if he can affirm his baptismal faith, but it's a good opportunity for all of us to be able to do that. Easter is a very appropriate Sunday for us to do that. So that's one of the things that we're going to be doing as a response to Jesus being alive again. That service of celebration for Easter Sunday. I think the one other thing to mention is that we're gearing up for our annual parochial church meeting, which is going to take place in May. If you are not currently on the church lecturer role and would like to be so, then if you'd see me, I can just give you a very simple form just to fill out so you can come onto the lecturer role if you would like to do so. If you're already on it, you don't need to do anything. That will just follow on automatically. Okay, just before we sing our final song, we're just going to watch another video just to refresh our memories, just to remind us what we've been thinking about this morning.
God's story. Peter denies Jesus. So remember how part of God's story is about a guy named Peter who walked on water with Jesus? Well, it goes like this. Peter followed Jesus, but like all of us, he wasn't perfect. Sometimes he messed up. One time, he even pretended not to know Jesus at all. Here's what happened. Jesus and his 12 disciples were going to different towns, showing more and more people that Jesus is God's son. But some people did not believe Jesus is God's son. They thought that was impossible. And they got so mad that Jesus said he was God's son that they tried to have him arrested, even killed. Turns out, Jesus had to die to rescue us. See, he was perfect, yet chose to come to our broken world and live and die just like us. But then he came back to life, which means Jesus really was sent from God and really is stronger than death. So now, even though we all mess up, we can follow Jesus and one day live with him forever. But at the time, Peter and the other disciples couldn't have known all that. They believed Jesus was God's son, but they didn't know how he would rescue us. One night, Jesus did get arrested. Peter and the disciples were sad and scared. And they could get into trouble too, just for following him. So when a servant girl recognized Peter and said, "This man was with Jesus," Peter said, "I don't know him." Then someone else called Peter a follower of Jesus and he said, "I am not." A third person said Peter knew Jesus and Peter said, "I don't know what you're talking about." Right then, a rooster crowed and Peter realized what he had done. In fact, Jesus had told Peter that he was going to deny him three times before the rooster crowed. But guess what? That means Jesus knew Peter would mess up before he even did anything, and Jesus loved him anyway. The best part is, he feels the same way about us. Peter would keep on following Jesus and show many more people how to follow Jesus, and we can too. And that's part of the story of Peter. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Peter messed up. People arrested Jesus. Peter pretended he didn't know Jesus. He did it again. He did it a third time. The rooster crowed. Jesus still loved Peter. We mess up too. Jesus still loves us. Peter followed Jesus. We can follow Jesus too. And that's a part of God's story.
Video very much picks up on the first part of the story that we're thinking about this morning. We're going to finish now with a song which picks up on the second part of the story, and this song is called His Master Spoke, and it reminds us again of how Jesus reinstated Peter and asked him three times, "Do you love me?"
You say, "But
thoughts you think, the prayers you pray, for I am he who all must know to make my Father's kingdom grow. Yes, I am he who must be heard. Jesus Christ, the living word. Today, to every nation, he sent his disciples out to tell of his salvation. For dying on his cross, yet many do not see. The gate to life is open wide. To Christ at Calvary, won't you feed my sheep? They all must hear, feed my sheep. You need not fear, for I am him. The words you say, the thoughts you think, the prayers you pray, for I am he who all must know to make my Father's kingdom grow. Yes, I am he who must be heard. Jesus Christ, the living word, feed my sheep.
Let's head up for the music room. Okay, so there are refreshments available at the back. Please do go and be served with them. Please do finish up or take away any of the food that's on your table. Please do take the opportunity to have a proper look at all the various different installations that we've got in the church. Huge thank you to so many people who have been here during the week setting all of this up. Please do go and have a proper look at all of that. And our next Cafe Church service is on Sunday, the 1st of May. So look forward to seeing you then. Thank you all for coming. Take care.